Welcome to Tanach Study and Sefer Study. I'm Nachliel Selavan, and you're watching Archaeology Snapshot for Sefer Shemuel. Now, before we get on to where we left off in last episode, just to overview what our goals are, is in every one of these Sefer Study episodes, our goal, our aim, is to cover the basic four questions, more or less, which is when it's happening, who are the main players, where are the geographic stories, and of course some highlights from history and archaeology. In no particular order, sometimes you have more than the other. It's sort of, you know, as you go. So let's get on with it. So I just want to remind us where we sort of left off. What we left off with last time is the death of Shaul and Yonatan. Not all of the children of Shaul, but some of the children of Shaul on the northern hills of the Gilboa in the Jezreel Valley in Emek Israel against the Plishtim. And I mentioned also that the division into Shmuel Aleph and Shmuel Bet is really a Christian one, which is sort of arbitrary. It's more of a convenience issue, sometimes even a theological issue, which at times is at odds with Torah. And so we don't take it too seriously. But I decided to sort of extend where Shmuel Aleph ends into wrapping up with David's kinah, his lamentation on Shaul and Yehonatan on the Gilboa Mountains, in order to be able to begin this episode of Shmuel Bet in a more smooth and coherent fashion. So what is the overview of Sefer Shmuel Bet? The overview of Shmuel Bet is basically the consolidation of Malchut David, of David haMelekh, of what we're going to call the eponymous founder of the kingdom of Judah, of Malchut Yehuda. Why am I saying the eponymous founder? Because in ancient Near Eastern tradition, a kingdom, a dynasty, is named after its founder. And that's what I mean by the eponymous founder. He's the founder who gives his name to the dynasty. And what I'm showing you in this image is a very important discovery, which we will talk about, Bezrat Hashem, in Sefer Melachim, which has to do with Hazael, the king of Aram, in a particular battle which happens over 100 years later. But in those words that are sort of gone over in white, it says Bet David. And this is referring to the killing of a king of Beit David. In other words, we have Hazael, possibly Hazael, but in any event, a king of Aram, a powerful enemy, who is naming a king after the eponymous ruler, the founder, Beit David. And so this Sefer is basically about Malchut Beit David in its various aspects. And so what we need to understand is from Hebron to Jerusalem, what David HaMelech did, the back and forth, rebellions, difficulties, battles, David and Bathsheba, Sheva ben Bichri, and on and on and on. There's a lot to go over. But that's basically what it's about. And it sort of ends when his kingdom, well, when his lifetime is sort of setting, and he's sort of setting the stage for his son, Shlomo HaMelech, to rule after him. So that's really where we end Shmuel Bet. And so what I'd like to point out now is just an overview of the Sefer. So the Sefer sort of begins when David HaMelech is king in Tziklag, and we're going to get to Tziklag very soon on the map. But the overview is that he was 30 years old when he started ruling, and he was a king for 40 years. So in Hebron, he was 7 years, or says there 7.5, not going into the back and forth, but this shows up with a half-year discrepancy. Chazal discussed this. So let's say 7.5 years in Hebron, and then 33 years in Yerushalayim, total of 40 years. We know that David HaMelech lived for 70 years, and then he died, which is usually what happens after you live. Anyway, so Hebron in Yerushalayim is really where he ruled as a king once Shaul is dead, but he also did have his period of time where they overlap with David HaMelech and he was in Tziklag. So let's get into it. Hebron. This is a picture I took in Tel Rumeda. Tel Rumeda is the archaeological site in Tel Hebron, in Hebron, and I did a whole bunch of material on that at another time, and hopefully we'll get into Hebron maybe a little bit later. But Hebron is a very important city in Malchut Yehuda, and after David HaMelech gets the news that Shaul dies, he moves, well, he asks in the Urim V'Tumim, and he gets the answer from Hashem, where should I go? He goes to Hebron. Hebron, we know, of course, is the connection to the Avot, to the Imahot. It's the place of Me'arat HaMachpelah. It's a place of Chibur, a place of connection, a place of friendship, which is why in Arabic it's called El Halil, the friend, right? Because that has to do with Chaveh, with Chibur. And this plaque from a certain part of the site there, if you go around it, shows you a very powerful Middle Bronze and Early Iron Age fortified city. So Hebron is a very important city. It was captured. There's the Anakim, there's Kalav ben Yefuneh, that was in Yoshua, Shoftim, not going in there right now. But Hebron is a very important city, and it's going to come back, as I mentioned, in Sefer Melachim with the Hebron LaMelech jug handles. So hang in for that. That's a little bit of a teaser. Now, I want to show you Herzog's HaTanach website, which I'm going to link in the description once more, the tutorial that I've done about it. But I want to show you right now a layers function. But first of all, what you can do with the map to enhance your learning of Tanach in its geographical setting, with some anecdotes from archaeology as well, because this website really has a lot of cool stuff. So I want you to see what I'm doing on the site. You see that there's these timelines on the side, or there is a filter, and what I'm doing is I'm now selecting the range that I want to look at. I want to look at Shmuel Bet, Perek Aleph through Hey, and I'm looking at the different locations. Now here is Tziklag, and if you click on it, you see there's Tziklag 1 or 4 or 2 because there's different options. There's how many times it's mentioned in Tanakh. There's some more recent archaeological discussions about the Hebrew University excavation there by Yossi Garfinkel. Here is Hebron, which is the second place David HaMelech goes, and you see that there's all these details. And finally, here is Yerushalayim, which you can click on it, and then it tells you it's mentioned 633 times in Tanakh. Check out the layers function, which only opens when you're in the proper range. This is Ir David. This is Malchut. This is Yerushalayim, that is, in the time of David HaMelech. We'll get to that later. Now click on the Temple Mount. This is the Second Temple period Temple Mount, but it does encompass the Temple Mount period, and this is the Old City as it is today, which is pretty much Ottoman. So this is also showing you a contemporary map, which is one of the functions you can do on the bottom left or bottom right, depending what language you are viewing it. It's available in Hebrew, in English, and in Spanish. I have a tutorial for Hebrew, English, not Spanish. Disculpame, por favor. Haven't done that yet. So this is the Herzog HaTanach website and map, and I highly recommend using it again and again. I can't stress it enough. It's got a lot of features, and you can always submit more comments and suggestions to Rabbi Dr. Shuki Rice of Herzog. He's really interested in improving this as a resource for educators. In any event, what we've seen is that David HaMelech moved from Tziklag, which is in the southern southwestern Negev, and moves up to Hebron, which is still in the south Judean hills, right? And then he moves up to Yerushalayim, and that pretty much sums up all of Sefer Shmuel Bet. Now, before we get into the big stuff, I wanted to give you one little highlight which has to do with a particular location and people. The book kicks off, Sefer Shmuel Bet kicks off with a tragic, tragic event, which has to do with when the two generals of Shaul, who sort of stayed in power with Ishbosheth or Ishbaal. There's a fun archaeological discussion about Boshet covering up for the word Baal. But anyway, let's just say Ishbosheth ben Shaul. And Ishbosheth ben Shaul was moved to Machanaim, which is here by the Abok, and we have David and Hebron, and they pass each other in a place called Giv'on, possibly El Jib. I'll get there in a moment, and which is northwest of Jerusalem. Okay, Jerusalem's not on this map right now because if you do the selecting the filter of what you're going to look at in the map, Jerusalem is not mentioned. Yerushalayim is not mentioned in this chapter. So they meet here in the Giv'on. There's a big pool in Giv'on, and they decide to fight it out with between them, 12 of each, the best and brightest, and it ends up becoming a bloodbath. It's a disaster. It almost started a civil war. Asael ben Tziruya, the brother of Yoav, is killed. Yoav harbors a grudge against Avner Benel, the general of Shaul, and kills him later. So we learn about Yoav a little bit more here as well, and he's going to be a very important character until the beginning of Melachim. And they have a fight. Now, what's really cool about this place is that there is a very ancient water pool. Now, while archaeologists you can say that there isn't a consensus about, is this the pool? It's probably not the pool of the story, but it's a pool in the area, and it's an area with pools. It makes sense that it's in this area. It's a place called El Jib, like sounds like Gib'on. So you can play with the Arabic name. They're usually very similar to the original biblical name, which is, by the way, a very unique characteristic of the land of Israel. You cannot count on that in other countries around the world. So that's kind of a cool historic coincidence, or a miracle, if you will, that the Arabic names very often preserve the original biblical name. But anyway, I heard from a friend of mine who was a Tanakh teacher that when he was a kid, back when this wasn't under the PA and Palestinian authorities, and you were able to visit this place, they had the idea of, once visiting this, let's act out the scene of 12 of Binyamin fighting against 12 of Yehuda, and it didn't end well. Let's put it that way. Not as bad as the original story, but let's just say 12 kids fighting each other outside a pool. No, not a good idea. But that was one thing I wanted to mention. And now let's get to some more serious stuff. The conquering of Yerushalayim. I would like to impinge upon you, to impress upon you the importance of Yerushalayim and its specific context, where it shows up. Why is it that now, for the first time, it's on the agenda? We tried to conquer Yerushalayim, it's mentioned in the Yoshua Shoftim, but it didn't really work. We didn't completely manage to remove the Canaanim and then the Yevusim from there. It was sort of left hanging and wasn't really maintained. And just so you know, that Yerushalayim is sort of on the northern border of Yehuda and southern border of Binyamin. It's in between Uven Ketefav Shachen. You know, it's connected to Binyamin and Yehuda. In any event, what happens? After Shaul dies, and this is in Shmuel Bet Perikei, all of the Zekenim, all of the leaders of the people of all of the 12 tribes, come to Hebron. Think chibur, connection, and they acknowledge David haMelech as the one who is the legitimate Mashiach Hashem, who has been anointed by Shem and Amishai, by Shmuel and Avi. He is indeed the legitimate and rightful king. And therefore, they gather together. And the next thing David haMelech does is he says, time to go to Yerushalayim. This is perhaps the first and maybe the last time in history where all of the leaders of Am Yisrael actually agreed upon something. Take a moment to think about that. Take that in. Yerushalayim, unity. The connection between all the Shvatim is what convinced David HaMelech, now is the time. To quote Martin Luther King, now is the time. Okay, I can't do it. To go to Yerushalayim. And then he goes to Yerushalayim. So we think of Yerushalayim like this picture, which is the Western Wall, the Kotel HaMa'aravi, which is a very small fraction of the very large wall. But this wall was built by none other than King Herod the Great, and it's barely 2,000 years old. The truth is that at the time of David HaMelech, Yerushalayim looked more or less like this. More or less. There's constant new discoveries which are changing this picture. The joke amongst archaeologists is by the time they come up with a picture, it's already changed. But the importance of this picture, which is from the City of David, which we're going to talk about in a bit, there's a few of their videos linked in the description, the City of David and their educational center, which is called Machon Megalim, the Megalim, or the Discovery, yeah? Megalim Institute, puts a lot of effort in educating people about ancient Jerusalem. They have a lot of very great material in Hebrew and in English, so I'm going to link their website. I'm going to link both of their websites and their YouTube channel in the description with a few specific videos, because it's really important that you get familiar with this. Some of the most recent discoveries are coming out of the City of David National Park. So this is the southern slopes of the City of Jerusalem. What we are going to be talking about is Jerusalem after the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash, and the second is obviously further north into the west. This is Yerushalayim at the time of David HaMelech before he conquers it. There's a massive, very ancient Canaanite middle bronze fortress which is protecting the spring, the Gihon, the water, and that's going to be a major part of our story. Now, how does David HaMelech conquer Jerusalem? Because it was so well fortified that even the Ivrim and the Pischim, the blind and the maimed, were able to stand on the walls taunting David HaMelech, saying, "You shall not pass!" Right? You're never going to get through here. Well, there was a discovery made in 1865 by Sir Charles Warren, who was surveying the area, and he discovered that there was an underground entrance into the water system with a shaft called Warren's Shaft, or Pir Warren in Hebrew, after Warren, who discovered that it goes up 13 meters into the city, and then you can sneak into the city from within while they have no idea where you're coming. And so I'm going to link in the description a beautiful video, well illustrated in Hebrew. I think it's also available in English. Do your homework. You'll enjoy it. It's worth the journey of looking around their YouTube channel, where David HaMelech basically sets a challenge, and he says, "Kol asher yiga batzino," whoever hits the water system and makes their way in, you know, they're going to be some sort of general, and so on. He promises them what he promises them, and Yoav ben Tzeruya steps up to the plate, sneaks in, opens the door as they're not expecting it, and David and his men come in and take over the city and establish it as Mitzudat David. They call it David's fortress, Tzion, Yir David, etc., etc., etc. So that's how we capture Jerusalem. Again, link in the description below to the Megalim Institute video about this. Now, David HaMelech eventually builds a palace here. He actually has Hiram, the king of Tzor, which is modern-day Lebanon, help him build it. Hiram is a name which comes up again and again and again in the Tyrian Phoenician kingdom to our north. So there's several people named Hiram. Hiram helps Shlomo HaMelech build the Beit HaMikdash as well. And you can see at the top of the city that they already built the Beit HaMikdash in this image. But again, this image is not, you know, it's not the time of David HaMelech. It's a little bit after. But the point is, you're getting the idea of how small the city was. It's like 11 football fields. It's pretty small. Now, here is the location which is estimated based on recent discovery and archaeology. You can go and visit the City of David National Park based on excavations by Elat Mazal of the Hebrew University, very nice lady, that this is probably where the Palace of David HaMelech is. Again, you can go there. There's a lot to see. And further here on top is the Beit HaMikdash, which again was built only in the time of Shlomo HaMelech, even though David HaMelech wanted to build it. Now, we know that Hiram, the king of Tzor, sent craftsmen and materials to help build David HaMelech a house. And Hiram, the king of Tzor, again, the name shows up several times because there are several kings named Hiram, of course. It's a kingdom, it's a dynasty. And this is the sarcophagus, the burial of Hiram Melech Tzor, a later one, which is, of course, in the National Museum in Beirut. Where else? Because it's in Lebanon. And so we know a lot about the Phoenicians, a lot about their building, a lot about their alliance with Judah and Israel, and we find ivories that have to do with them. We're going to get to that, Be'ezrat Hashem, later in Melachim. We're going to talk about the ivory palaces of Achav. Beautiful story. Now, what I wanted to mention is, once David HaMelech starts building his home, he's like, I'm sitting in Beit Arazim, I'm sitting in a home of cedars of wood, and Aron HaElohim betoch HaYiriah, it's out there. It's like, let's bring it up to Yerushalayim. So the story, and this is a Temple Institute image. Again, I do have permission to use their images explicitly from Rav Ariel, who's their the founder. So this is an image of carrying the Aron up from where it was in Kiryat Yearim on a wagon. And the story of Peretz Be'uzah is that Uzah and Achyo, you know, they were part of the people there. The wheel fell off, and Uzzah comes to pick up the Aron, which was falling off, and Hashem kills him. Why? Because they were supposed to carry it on their shoulders and not... Anyway, that's part of the story, but you see David HaMelech here in red, and there he's dancing, and he's singing, and eventually he brings it up from Beit Oved Edom HaGiti, he brings it up to Yerushalayim. Now, the beautiful story there, if you've been keeping track of my challenge earlier on in Shoftim, the women from the window, there was M. Sisra, Sisra's mother looking from the window. That was number one. Here's the second example in Tanach. Michal bat Shaul, the royal woman looking out of the window of the palace at David HaMelech and going, and that didn't really end out so well. But in any event, women from the window, two out of three. There's one more in Tanach. If you know who it is, let me know. Some of you have already written to me. I do appreciate it. There's one more in Tanach that's going to show up, which is much more related to Phoenicians than Michal and Sisra. But anyway, that was the capturing of Jerusalem, and that's the palace of David HaMelech. Now, an overview to wrap up of Sefer Shemuel and Shemuel Bet and Malchut David is really the extent of the influence and control of David HaMelech. There's many stories of his encounters with Ammon, with Edom, there's the Geshurim, there's stories with the Plishtim and Baal Pratzim, there's Aram Damesek, and he deals with Hadad Ezer, and he goes all the way to Toi, the king of Hamat. I mean, it's a very broad discussion, and I will say that there isn't any consensus in archaeology about finding fortifications which demonstrate that there's a kingdom that can make fortifications. There is no consensus about what we can find from the time of David HaMelech. There's a lot of questions about it. And some will say, this never happened. Some will say, I don't know, I wouldn't be so skeptical. What I'd like to add to you now, just in terms of archaeology, is that there's a recent discovery, and when I say recent, I mean now during the coronavirus, right now, just a few weeks ago, or maybe a few months ago, where they discovered a fortified city in the Golan Heights from the time of David HaMelech, and there's a discussion about who it's from, but that sort of adds to the discussion, and it shows you we're constantly discovering new things. Archaeology is constantly rewriting itself. Don't get too excited when people say we don't find any evidence of this and that. You never know what's going to come up and how we understand things. So this is a map, as several of them have been, from the Sacred Bridge, which is an excellent, excellent resource for studying Tanach with an eye on history, archaeology, and maps. But in any event, this shows you the sphere of influence of Yehuda and Israel, the unified monarchy, which we're going to talk about more in Sefer Melechim Aleph, but that's the blue or purple area is pretty much David HaMelech. We have the green in the area which he conquered later on, and the sphere of influence which he didn't conquer is other places. So for example, I'm going to mention Mered Avshalom. Avshalom, who is Avshalom? Avshalom is a son from a political marriage after David HaMelech was able to conquer or have some sort of alliance with Geshur. Now, who is Geshur? Geshur is most likely an outpost of Aram. In other words, we find a lot of connections between the characteristics, the material culture of what is the area of Geshur, more or less, which is the Golan Heights, it's the Bashan, it's east of the Kinneret, and Aram in terms of their deities, material culture, and so on and so forth. So one example is this monument, probably of Hadad. Hadad is the storm god. The storm god is usually attributed with the bull because the rumbling, snarling bull sort of reminds you of the rumbling sound of thunder. And so the bull is very much associated with the thunder god, who's also called Baal. So bull, Baal, fun, huh? And we can also talk about Et Baal, the king of the Tzidonim, who we're going to mention in just a second. But also he is related to he's a Phoenician king. He's the father of Izebel, who married Ahav. Again, that's Melachim. But the point is that there is the equivalent god in different pantheons, in different cultures, but it's the same character. So, for example, the Greeks will have him as Zeus, the thunder god. The Phoenicians, the Canaanim, really, will have him as Baal. And the Aramim will have him as Hadad. So Hadad Ezel, or Ben Hadad, Hadan Ben Bedad, etc., etc. You get the idea. Now, this image actually shows up, a similar one shows up in the recent discovery in the Golan Heights, which is why there's a suggestion of maybe it's one of the outposts of the Geshuri, maybe it has to do with these political marriages, there's like an influence. That's a fun conversation, and I'm going to link that video as well in the description, so look out for that. And finally, after the Battle of Avshalom, we have this guy from Binyamin with seven fingers. You know, think of the Princess Bride. He has six fingers on his right hand. He has seven fingers. This is Sheva ben Bichri. Now, Sheva ben Bichri ends up hiding in Avel Bet Ma'acha, which is here on the map. And this is an image of the Tel Avel Bet Ma'acha. And very, very recently, I'm saying just within the last 2 years, maybe three, I don't really remember, but very, very recently, there was an excavation there where they discovered the head of a king, and it's currently on display in the Israel Museum right next to the Tel Dan stela, the inscription that says Beit David on it, which shows up in the beginning. There's a discussion about who is this head. Is this head of a king Hazael, the king of Aram? Is this Etbal, the king of the Tzidonim? We don't know. It's a mystery, but there's an article about it, and I'm linking that as well in the description so you can read about this exhibition in the Israel Museum. But this is pretty much wrapping up the story of David HaMelech's kingdom, and there's a lot of details to talk about. I'm going to wrap up with the most important one, with the crescendo, with the ending of Melechim Bet and the setting of the stage for the next step of Shlomo HaMelech, and that is the Temple Mount. And so Sefer Shmuel Bet ends with David HaMelech sending Yoav to conduct a census in all of Israel, and this map, again from the Sacred Bridge, shows you the trajectory of how Yoav goes throughout Malchut Israel. So you can basically see what's the extent of our population. So there's value to mapping out the story, which we wouldn't have thought of when we're just looking at the text, right? So that's really cool. So after that, of course, there's a magefa, because who goes ahead and counts Am Yisrael for no good reason, right? And so David HaMelech has this vision of a malach with v'chalbo shlufa b'yado al Yerushalayim. He has a sword drawn out over Yerushalayim, and he realizes that there's something unique about this place in Yerushalayim, which is the threshing floor, the goren of a Yevusi named Aravna. So David HaMelech goes to Aravna Yevusi, and he wants to purchase that piece of land, which is the height of the city. Now, what we need to understand about this just geographically is that the Syrian-African rift, it catches the wind in the perfect way it's a great threshing floor for separating the chaff from the grain, right? You just throw it out and throw it up in the air, and then the wind comes and blows away all the chaff and you have the grain. That's a threshing floor. This is prime real estate, and David HaMelech purchases it from Aravna Yevusi, stops the Magefa, and dedicates that area for the building of the Beit HaMikdash. So this is a bird's eye view of a model of the first Beit HaMikdash built by Shlomo HaMelech just a few years later in the Bible Lands Museum, Jerusalem, which is, by the way, across the street from the Israel Museum. And hopefully these museums will open soon by the time, you know, you see this video is here for posterity. But in any event, the Sefer ends with purchasing the land and setting the stage for the grandeur, the golden age of Yerushalayim under Shlomo HaMelech, who's going to build up Yerushalayim and build the first Bet HaMikdash, which David HaMelech dreamt of doing but was never able to do. And that's all I have for today. I want to thank you so much for watching yet another episode of Sefer Study and to encourage you to follow TanachStudy.com. Link to everything in the description. Comment, subscribe, like, share, follow the podcast, mailing list, YouTube, Facebook, you name it. Thanks for watching. That was another episode of Archaeology Snapshot. I'm Nachliel Selavan, and see you next time.